Hi, good evening, everyone. My name is Amanda Chun, and I am the Research Manager and Curator at MS Rao. Thank you all for joining us for our fifth webinar in the Bourbon with Bill series. It is so wonderful to have everyone back again. I personally have been greatly enjoying these webinars, and I'm so glad that you have all decided to stick with us during this series. This evening, we have something extra special planned for you. Not only will we be chatting with third generation owner and CEO of MS Rao, Mr. Bill Rao, but we are also welcoming his eldest daughter, Rebecca Rao. Now, not only does Rebecca oversee strategic development at the gallery, but she also directs our Rao for Art Foundation, which awards scholarship money to talented local high school artists. Rebecca received a Master's of Art Business at Sotheby's Institute of Art in London, where she graduated with distinction. She is now in New Orleans on the board of YPO Next Generation Louisiana, the Vu Curie Commission Foundation, the New Orleans Photo Alliance, and is involved with and supportive of a number of other fine art and cultural causes in New Orleans and beyond. We are so thrilled to have her with us tonight. We invited Rebecca here because we're focusing this evening on the realm of fine art, which is her specialty. Of course, Bill is no stranger to art history himself, having authored an important book on 19th century European painting, and of course, for having been in this business for as long as he has. The discussion is sure to be an interesting one with these two. Now, like all of our webinars, we are going to be focusing on works that are currently hanging in our gallery, but we will consider them within a larger art historical context, specifically Impressionism and the styles that came after it, Post-Impressionism and American Impressionism. If at any point throughout our conversation you have a question about a painting, about these styles, or about the gallery in general, you can feel free to ask. Just simply press that Q&A button that's at the bottom of your screen to send in a question. We're gonna try to answer as many of those as we can. Now, if any of you attended our last webinar on jewelry, you know that we had a ton of questions that unfortunately we weren't able to get to. So tonight, if we have the same number of questions come through, we are going to extend this a little bit. So you might get a little bit of extra time with Bill and Rebecca tonight. Without further ado, I would like to welcome these two. Hi, Bill and Rebecca Rao. How are you both doing this evening?
Doing well, thank you, Amanda.
We're doing great. We're looking forward to this.
We're so happy to have you here. And let's jump right in, shall we? Rebecca, before we take a look at these paintings, can you give us a general intro to Impressionist painting and explain exactly what makes it so revolutionary in the history of art?
My pleasure, Amanda. As many of you probably know, I do really consider Impressionism to be a revolutionary movement. And part of that is because it was a clear break with the art that came before, and it also really set the stage for all of the art that could come afterwards. Couldn't imagine 20th century modernism or contemporary art that you would see today if Impressionism hadn't anticipated those movements. So just to situate you within time, this is, think back to 19th century, largely in Paris. The Salon, the École des Beaux-Arts, was really set the stage for what was considered important and beautiful and worthy in terms of subject matter to be seen by the public. And there was a group of artists who we'll talk about tonight who wanted to break free from that. And some of these artists were successful in exhibiting their works in the Salon, but many times they were rejected. So in 1874, a group of artists came together. They created the Anonymous Society of Artists, technically of painters, sculptors, and printmakers, but a little long-winded there. And they created this Anonymous Society exhibition. And that's where the term Impressionism originated. I'll talk a little bit more about how the term came to be, but keep in mind, this was a reaction to the time and the place and the feeling of their environment. They were outdoors. They were enjoying the way the sunlight bounced off of the landscape. It wasn't so much about painting things as they thought they should be. It was about painting things as they were experiencing them in the moment.
Great. Thank you, Rebecca. That's a great summation. And these next paintings that we're going to talk about are certainly important examples of the movement. Let's jump right in. The first, this is a very intimate portrait that one Impressionist painted of another. Bill, can you tell us the story about this beautiful portrait?
Oh, of course. So if you ask most people, you know, who are the most famous Impressionists, Monet's name, Renoir's name would certainly come up, Degas' name. However, in their day, by far the most prestigious, the most important, the most desirable artist of them all was Edouard Manet. Manet had already made it. He had already exhibited the Salon. He already was, he had major, major, major collectors wanting his work. And he was also extraordinarily important for one main reason. He was the artist that gave the Impressionists legitimacy. And when he was the important artist that switched from realism to Impressionism. And without that switching, we may not be sitting here today talking about Impressionist art. Because Manet was very famous, and Manet put a lot of work into his paintings, he did not paint a lot of paintings. He didn't need to. He would paint a wonderful painting, put a lot of effort into it, and most of Manet's paintings are in museums. So a Manet is something that rarely comes on the market. Renoirs come on the market. They're not easy to find by any stretch of the imagination, but they do come on the market. Monets come on the market, not anywhere near as often as Renoir, but still hard. Manet's rarely there. There may be a Manet that comes on the market once every 5 or 10 years. So this is not only a painting by Manet, but it's also an important painting because it's a painting of a fellow Impressionist, somebody almost as famous as him, Bertha Morisot. Bertha Morisot was arguably the most famous female artist in France. You can make a case that Rosa Bonheur was up there, and certainly a case that the American Impressionist Mary Cassatt achieved almost as much fame as she did. But Bertha Morisot was the most famous female Impressionist. She was, in fact, there were numerous Impressionist exhibitions, and she was the only Impressionist, not the only female Impressionist, she was the only Impressionist that exhibited in every single exhibition. So here she is with Edward Manet. And they were rumored to be lovers. I wasn't there. I can't comment if that was true. But they were rumored to be lovers, and he painted these intimate portraits of her. He painted, I believe there were 7 of them total. And this was the last one he painted. Why did he stop? Because she ended up marrying his brother and became his sister-in-law. So we have this extraordinarily famous painter by her own right being shown in this really soft, stunning Impressionist work painted in Manet's studio, painted in his home of Bertha Morisot. So you have this great painting by this highly important, the most important Impressionist in the day, of Bertha Morisot, of another Impressionist. And what I particularly like about this, and you don't see this, Impressionist paintings do not photograph as well as they view, as a general rule. And you don't really see how stunningly beautiful this is, because when you look at the painting, you sit down and you go, wow, and you could just stare at it. It's to me, it's art with a capital A.
Great, thank you, Bill. And we actually have our first question from the audience about that one. The question is, was it common during this period for artists to paint fellow artists?
That's a great question. And the answer is yes and no. It was exceptionally common for painters to paint each other. They were very incestuous. They lived in the same places. They went to the same bars. They painted in the same places, and they would, of course, paint each other. However, the reason why I know is it was very uncommon for a male painter to paint a female painter. First of all, there weren't many female painters. It was just the beginning where this was allowed. In fact, I mentioned Rosa Bonheur before. She used to dress up as a man to go outside and paint because she got so much abuse if she went out dressed as a female. But not only that, Bertha Morisot was a lady of means. And where you see a lot of paintings of females, they were models, they were prostitutes, they were dancers, they were people that accepted the job to be painted because they needed the money. Bertha Morisot didn't need the money. And so to have an intimate painting of her, done in his salon where they would have been alone, was something that was not common at all.
Agreed. Okay. Thank you, Bill. So you mentioned that Manet was this de facto leader of Impressionism, but one can argue that Monet was really the one who pushed the limits of the style. We have a wonderful oil by this artist currently in the gallery. Rebecca, would you mind telling us a little bit more about this work?
Sure thing. So one of the reasons Monet is so closely associated with the movement and the name of the movement is because, as I implied earlier, it came from one of his paintings. Now, he titled a painting that he exhibited in 1874, that Society of Anonymous Artists exhibition, he titled it Impression Sunrise. And an art critic at the time really got a kick out of this, used it against him. He thought that that by calling it an impression, it was actually dismissive. It suggested it was a study, it was an unfinished work, it couldn't be taken seriously. So he snubbed the impression, Monet and his fellow impressionists of that exhibition, but they actually took pride in this idea, kind of, which relates to what I was saying before. They really liked connecting with the landscape and that allowed them to. Also, it's sort of a great PR thing, right? So they're overturning what the critic says. So anyway, in short, Monet is very closely, he's sometimes considered the father of Impressionism. I'll tell you a little bit about the artist and then we'll dive into this work. So before he became part of the Society of Anonymous Artists, he did have a few works that were accepted to the Salon, but some of his most ambitious works that in the late 1860s that he was super proud of, they were rejected. And that allowed him to kind of break with the societal expectations and really confront his own passions and his own interests. Some of those interests were things like Japanese woodblock prints, which had flooded Paris in the era. These are really interesting for these artists, for Degas, for Monet, for a handful of these artists, because all of a sudden they have new ideas of what a composition can look like and what is accepted. Japanese woodblock prints feel very spatially different. You can tell that it's a flat picture plane and they embrace that. They're not reliant on the need to be heavily modeled and feel three-dimensional. And I think you start to feel some of those explorations come into play. Interestingly enough, that's what a lot of modern art is about, is drawing attention to the fact that the medium is a painting. Anyway, back to Monet. So something that he took from the generation that came before, the Barbizon painters were known for painting en plein air, but the reality is most of the Barbizon painters were doing their initial studies or sketches, preliminary sketches on canvas before finishing the works back in their studios. Monet was interesting, and alongside many of other Impressionists, because he took his large scale canvases out into the field and painted and completed them en plein air. In the 1890s, Monet, so this painting dates to the late 1880s, and it sort of anticipates what Monet becomes most famous for, where he's known in the 1890s to create series of paintings. So you've probably seen the series of the Haystacks or Rouen Cathedral or Westminster Abbey. This is sort of right at the beginning of that part of his career. And he found a landscape or a site that really inspired him. This is from the Creuse Valley in central France. He went to visit a friend there and he painted it at various points in the day. And he really showed how the light changes and evolves and how the feeling of this site changes over the course of a day. Clearly this series is considered an important one of the artist. We know that because a couple of museums have these works in their collection. Here are some examples from the Museum of Fine Art in Boston and the Musée Unterlinden in Colmar. And I just love how rich and kind of moody the palette is. I believe we have a detailed photograph in here where you see the impasto, and kind of, as my father mentioned before, it's beautiful in a photograph, but when you see it in person, you understand that Impressionist paintings were meant to be seen both from afar and close up. You understand their technique close up, but when you step back, it creates this beautiful picturesque landscape. So we're really happy to have this one in the collection.
Great. Thank you, Rebecca. And we do actually have a question about this one, or Monet in general, actually. This person asks, recently, a Monet broke auction records for selling over $100 million. What makes some paintings by Monet more valuable than others?
Let me answer it.
Sure.
So I think that's a great question. First of all, I want to state that every artist had an average day, a good day, a bad day, and a great day. However, I would venture that if you put good to great, or even average to great on Monet, there's a very 99% of his paintings fell in there, and the difference was not that much. So why does a painting bring 110 or 115 million? And the reason is that was part of the haystack scene. Haystacks were one of the paintings that Monet became very famous for, and it's very, it'd be great for somebody, for an art collector ego to say, I have a haystack painting. The reality is though, if you put the haystack next to our painting, and the haystack that sold for over $100 million was a great painting, I don't want to say anything wrong about it, but if you put it next to our painting and ask 100 people which one they like better, I would be willing to wager at least 25 of those 100 which is ours, because it really is just a choice. But there are scenes, the water lilies, the haystacks, the Charing Cross Bridge, some of the cathedral paintings that are very desirable to own for a collector, and you know, from a, I would say, a bragging rights. But the reality is they're not really much prettier or any prettier than our Monet or most of his good works.
Thank you, Bill. So let's move on to our next work tonight. Renoir was another leading painter of the Impressionist movement, and he's certainly, I think, one of the most diverse artists of the Impressionists, in terms of his subjects, at least. I personally enjoy his landscapes best, and we have a particularly great one in our collection right now. Bill, what can you tell us about this painting?
Renoir, an art critic once stated that Renoir was the only artist that never painted a sad scene. And I think that's so wonderful, because Renoir, you look at it, you just want to smile. That you really do. And so here's this superb Renoir. Now also, Renoir typically used only a certain amount of colors in his palette, whereas Monet and virtually every other artist used from A to Z in colors. He uses greens, he uses those yellows, he uses those blues and whites, and that was it in 98% of his paintings. And you can walk into a museum and be 200 yards away, where you can just sort of see a painting from a distance and know that it's a Renoir. And you can't really do that with almost any other artist. I mean, there's certainly there, you know, if you saw a haystack's Monet from a distance, you would assume that it's a Monet, but when you see a Renoir from distance, you know it's a Renoir. So Renoir was somebody that became very famous in his own day, and he lived a long time, and he created a lot of wonderful paintings. But later on in life, he was painting a lot of small paintings. This one has scale to it, which is really nice. And when you sit in front of it, you actually feel like you're there. It has this stream, and it's flowing. Now, Rebecca mentioned painting in plein air, which means painting outside. This is really, really important. And often, rules don't get broken without both people that are willing to break them, but also technology. And what was the technology? In the 1850s, something happened that had never happened before. Two paints came out, paint in a tube. Why is that important? Before, if you wanted to paint, you had to bring bring paint crystals, you had to bring oil, you had to bring your painting in an easel, and you had to go set up, and then you had to mix the paint when you were there. And of course, the problem is you're mixing green and you use all the green and you go pour some in again. Are you going to have the same color green or not? Is it going to be a little bit stronger, a little bit weaker? You know, because it's not consistent. It could freeze when it's outside, if it was cold. Certainly in the wind, if you were outside and you can sort of see where this was, you can sort of feel the wind blowing. In the wind, if you were putting crystals in the oil to dissolve, they could blow away. Two paints changed all that, and they allowed somebody to paint outside. Being an Impressionist painter also was extraordinarily important because they were not trying to get that realistic touch to everything. And what do I mean by that? An art history professor of mine many years ago used this analogy. He said, if I see my wife wail across the room and she's walking towards me way away, I know it's my wife. And there's things about her that I just know it's her. He goes, I can't tell you if she has a blouse on that has 5 buttons or 4 buttons, or if her collar's 3 inches long or 2 3/4 inches or 2.5 inches long. He goes, I see this impression of her coming and I know it's her. And so the Impressionists, and particularly Monet and Renoir, would go out there and because they were painting these soft, quick brushstroke paintings with these beautiful colors on it, they were able to paint them quicker. So they could go out and often complete the whole painting outside. Not always, but often. I mean, obviously it rained in places and got cold and got too hot or whatever the case. But they were able to paint whole paintings outside and finish them. And that's why the technology of the two paints, which was brand new technology, and the Impressionists breaking the molds of what an art should look like, were so important. And this is just such a beautiful painting, and I could stare at it all day.
Great, thank you, Bill. We actually have a comment from the audience, not so much a question, but I would like to see if you have a certain take on it. This gentleman says, besides Tubepank, I read that development and accessibility of trains allowed Impressionists to reach different locations to paint. I wonder what your thoughts are on that, and maybe how an Impressionist's ability to reach these different locations influenced their style all the more so.
Sure, I can speak to that. And you also see, in a number of artists' work, you also see the theme of trains and industrialization, urbanization being introduced. So I think I interpret that as the Impressionists knowing that they're part of a future-looking movement. So whereas artists like William Adolf Bouguereau and members of the Salon were really looking to the past and idealizing the past, they were excited about the future. They were excited about urbanization, industrialization, and they wanted to take advantage of the fact that they could live kind of a dual city-country life and paint and experience both settings.
And I'll add to that, the train allowed an artist, for the first time in history, you're in this big city, get on a train, and you could be out in the country in an hour or 45 minutes, paint all day, and get the train back and be asleep in your own bed that night. That didn't happen if you had to take a horse and buggy. And so that technology also allowed people to experience nature, which was very difficult to experience, because it would have been too difficult to experience without that.
Definitely.
Great. Thank you both so much.
And that's a great comment, by the way.
Yes, it was a great comment. I just want to remind everyone else, we've had a lot of great questions so far. If you have a question about anything, feel free to use that Q&A button down at the bottom of the screen there. We'll get to as many as we can. All right. So next up, we are going to look at something that's a little bit different. Impressionism may have been this distinctly French movement, but that doesn't necessarily mean that its influence did not spread far and wide. These next two paintings are going to take a look at something that comes from across the pond. They are important examples of American Impressionism. Before we dive right in, Rebecca, can you explain a little bit about how American Impressionism developed?
Absolutely. So there's not a giant distinction between French Impressionism and American Impressionism, but there are a few things I'd like to note. Most importantly, American Impressionism came slightly later. You could argue that it was a reaction to Impressionism. The French Impressionists kind of built that momentum. And then when it started to finally become appreciated by collectors and the broader public, there were some very entrepreneurial artists in the US who figured, hey, there's a taste for this, there's interest in this, how about I learn and suit these collectors' needs and desires and paint in this style. So the majority of the biggest names, some of whom we'll talk about today, folks like Child Hassam, Mary Cassatt, William Merritt Chase, and others, actually went and studied in Paris and then brought the technique back to the US. So these things being said, it has a feel that is unique, because whenever you change the time period slightly and take a technique to a new location, it's going to evolve. And keep in mind, the landscapes are not the same. So they're reacting to new situations, new locations, and continuing this legacy that the French Impressionists created in a special American way.
Great, thank you, Rebecca. And one of the biggest names in American Impressionism is William Merritt Chase. He was not only a painter of significance, but he was also an important teacher that really helped to develop this distinctly American style of Impressionism. We are lucky enough to have one of his paintings currently in our collection. Bill, can you tell us a little bit about this fascinating work?
Well, certainly. So William Merritt Chase was also somebody that really went from realism to Impressionism, became a convert, studied in France, and then came back and decided he wanted to teach. And he was instrumental in teaching literally thousands of artists, how to paint great works. But this one is particularly special because at the end of his life, he goes out to California to teach some Western students how to paint. And when he's there, he paints this famous scene of Carmel by the Sea. Now, this is a scene that many of us have seen on TV shows. Many people that follow golf, this is where Pebble Beach is today. It's this beautiful scene that obviously there's buildings there today, but the scene, it obviously looks exactly the same. It's just this stunningly beautiful painting by William Merritt Chase, done in his leisure after he had taught his students in California. And he loved the view so much, he promised that he would come back there every year to both teach and paint because he thought it was so stunning. Sadly, he got ill after and died shortly after and never made it back. So this was his great California painting. And it has it all. Do we have a close-up of the impasta on it? I believe we do. We have the slide with the close-up of the impasta. Yeah, it's the impasta is so thick you can sort of see it on the bottom of the piece. It becomes three-dimensional when you look at it. You don't see that when you're looking at a photograph of the painting, but when you see it in person, you just feel like you're there, and you could feel the ocean. You could feel the wind from the Pacific Ocean coming right in your face. It's so lovely and. It's by one of the great American masters of all time.
Thank you, Bill. You've said countless times that Impressionist works need to be viewed in person to really be appreciated. I definitely think that's one of them. I love that painting so much. It's really a wonderful piece, and hopefully everyone can come into the gallery someday soon to see it. It's a lovely, lovely landscape. All right, so our next work tonight is by another central figure in American Impressionism, the great Childe Hossam. This example of his work is one of my personal favorites right now that we have in the gallery. Rebecca, can you explain exactly why this one stands out?
Sure, I'm also a huge fan of this painting, so I'm excited to tell you all a little bit about it. One of the reasons I love Hossam as an artist, in addition to the fact that he was clearly very talented and very ambitious, is that he was aware of his place in history. He knew that he wanted to leave a mark and be remembered as an artist. He was documented as saying, "The man who will go down to posterity is the man who paints his own time in the scenes of everyday life around him." And that's exactly what he did. And this is a clear example. I'll tell you a little bit about his life. He, like many of the American Impressionists, he grew up in the New England area outside of Boston, and he apprenticed to a wood engraver early on. But he had the opportunity in 1886 to go over to Paris, where he studied in France with some of the Impressionists, befriended them, worked alongside them, and then returned to New York in 1889, a few years later. Hossam, like many of the artists, and as we discussed before, really enjoyed dividing time between the country and the city. But what I love about this painting is he merges all three of his most favorite subject matter. So that's, well, you could argue four: country, city, women of leisure, New York landmarks, and his family. So this painting here is a portrait of his wife and his daughter in Central Park. Now, Central Park was completed in the 1870s, so it's still a relatively new, fresh environment, an exciting place for artists to visit. It was a short walk from Hossam's brief New York, his apartment on West 57th Street. And I love this piece because there's so much sensitivity. You can really feel that he was in tune with his surroundings and with the light. There's a beautiful compositional elements happening throughout, but I'm particularly fond of the way that there's dappled light in the foreground. You can feel it kind of coming through the trees and how that would shift as the sun moves and as there's wind. Hossam is celebrated for, like I said, a few different subject matters, but the handful of scenes of Central Park that he did are highly appreciated on the market. And we know that because two of the four of his top best-selling paintings at auction also depicted Central Park. Those achieved $5.6 and $4.5 million in auction, making ours look very reasonable. But this painting is exciting to me because, additionally, because it's been super well cared for. Especially, we know it was a favorite of the artist, probably, I'm assuming because of his wife and daughter in there, and he refused to sell it. It stayed in his studio and in his collection until he passed away. He then went on to bequeath it to the American Academy of Arts and Letters. It briefly had a stint belonging to a private collector, but then ended up back in the museum, Virginia Museum of Fine Arts, whom we bought it from. So it's in pristine collection. If museums do many things well, one of them is caring for their artworks, and it's almost like it's fresh out of the studio. You can really feel the artist's energy and his enthusiasm for kind of his return to New York and being with his family. It's been sought after. In addition to being owned by museums, it's been sought after by quite a few. It's been exhibited on loan in Italy, a couple of museums in the U.S., including the museum in Fort Lauderdale, the Taubman Museum, and you can certainly understand why.
Great, thank you. We have another great question about this piece and about Impressionist works in general. The question is, Parks are featured in a number of Impressionist works. What was it about Parks that these artists liked so much?
Sure. I'd say the same. It kind of relates to what we talked about before, the idea that they're really embracing industrialization and urbanization. The cities were growing in size super rapidly around this period of time, and it allowed the artists to feel like they're escaping back into nature, but still kind of living the exciting cosmopolitan life that cities had to offer. A lot of these artists hung out with each other and got a lot of energy from the city, but as a subject matter, they really still cared about nature, and the park offered that for them.
Great, thank you, Rebecca.
Good question.
So we are going to wrap things up in America, head on back to France, and we're going to consider another movement that originated there that's directly related to Impressionism, Post-Impressionism. Rebecca, would you mind giving us a brief overview of what that term means and the styles that it encompasses?
Sure. I'll be very brief because it's a little bit hard to synthesize. Basically, if you take it literally, this is post-impressionism, so it's taking impressionism a step further, where the impressionists were kind of reacting to what exactly they saw in front of them. Post-impressionism was bringing a new element into these styles. So what I mean by that is they were including things like they were pushing the boundaries with things like color and technique. All of a sudden, you start to see these highly expressive colors. It's not literally the scene before them, but it's the scene as they feel it and choose to depict it. So there's a development in these emotional colors and techniques. Think of artists like Cézanne and Van Gogh and Gauguin. And then the other sort of main wing of post-impressionism that we'll focus on tonight is the more technical one. And that's artists like Seurat, who wanted to focus on the scientific capabilities of art, who really studied and understood the science of optics and how that related to painting. So we'll talk about pointillism and an approach to post-impressionism that was beautiful and also technical.
Great, thank you. And as you said, the two works that we're going to discuss tonight are both significant examples of the pointillist movement. The first one is actually by a Belgian artist, Georges Marin. Bill, I know that this one is a favorite of yours. Can you tell us a little bit about it?
Sure. Georges Marin was amazing. He studied with Seurat, studied with Signac. And he was so amazingly talented, and he had a number of major paintings, this being certainly one of them, if not his best painting that he ever did. It's this wonderful wet nurse. Let's go to the main scene, to the whole scene, so that we can see the whole picture. A wet nurse in the park, and it's so wonderful. First of all, She's apart from everything, and it's very daring for an artist to have so much negative space. But Morin achieves perfection with that. She just pops off the canvas, and it's the colors on this. The yellow is something that you would see in a Van Gogh painting, and the blues and the quality. I believe we have a close up of the impasto, don't we? Is that next picture? Okay, we may be having some technological difficulties, so don't worry about that right now. Oh, there it is. Here we go. You can sort of look at the detail of the impasto and the paint, and how, like, you can see the creases in her shoulder and the layers. It becomes three-dimensional, and the beauty of her face. And this is, to say this is a masterpiece would be an understatement. The Musée d'Orsay, which is the most famous museum for Impressionist and Post-Impressionist works in the entire world, rarely buys a painting. They just bought for over $1 million the mate to this painting. I believe we have a picture of it next. It's here it is. Now, the one they bought is on the right, ours on the left. The way this is photographed, it looks like the one on the right is actually larger than ours. It's actually about 40% smaller than our painting. It's the exact same park with the exact same model wearing the exact same coat. And they just bought this because they thought, and there's no better stamp of approval than the Musée d'Orsay spending over $1 million for a painting by the artist. And he painted two great paintings. I would argue that ours is better. It's bigger, it's slightly more detailed. And then if we can go back to ours again, the full picture. I love it because it's you know, this is art with a capital A.
I agree. He's clearly super, super talented. And the other reason I love this painting is because he might have been working in the latest and greatest technique, but that being pointillism, but he clearly was well aware of the artists that came before him. You know, this could easily be a scene upon first glance by Raphael. It has that sort of classical Renaissance composition with the triangular and with her bonnet and cape. It feels like she's almost a Madonna in child. So it's cool that he's elevating this wet nurse to be almost a Madonna figure. And to me, that's what makes it extra special.
That's some great insight. Thank you both so much. All right, last but certainly not least is a really highly important painting in the history of pointillism. Rebecca, would you mind explaining the significance of this oil by Georges Seurat?
Yes, we are very pleased to have this in the gallery. You may or may not know that Georges Seurat passed away at the age of 31. So he was not very prolific, understandably. And part of that had to do with his age, but part of that had to do with his technique. Obviously, pointillism or divisionism, which he preferred to call it, even though they're essentially synonymous, was super time consuming. The idea is that when you step back, the colors will optically mix. So it's up close, the detail is kind of captivating and interesting, but when you step away, you start to understand the scene develops before your eyes. Georges Seurat, he started studying scientific theory behind optics in the 1870s, and he sort of follows the same trajectory of a lot of the Impressionists, but in a slightly later time period. So in 1883, he was able to exhibit in the Salon, and then 1884, he's rejected. He joins with other major post-Impressionists and pointillists like Henry Cross, Paul Signac, Odilon Redon, and a number of other artists. They create the famous Salon des Indépendants, another sort of revolutionary art historical moment. And that's where Seurat kind of takes fame. Back to this painting, what I think is interesting about it within the context of his short career is that he had begun working on his masterpiece. If you are like me, you also might have been a big fan of Ferris Bueller's Day Off. Back when that came out, therefore consider a Sunday afternoon on the island of Grand Chateau to be super iconic to you and globally. So this painting he had begun that same year, and he wasn't getting it right. He felt like he still needed to perfect this technique. As any good Frenchman does, he went to the coast. He spent some time in Normandy over the summer. He did a number of paintings of the seaside. When he went on vacation, that's when he tended to paint scenes that kind of reminded us in subject matter of the Impressionists. And our sailboats at Grand Camp are no exception. So anyway, he returns to Paris after vacationing, completes this this masterpiece, and this ultimately becomes one of the famous, most famous works of all time. But when you see them side by side, ours is a bit looser, a bit more playful, but you can see that he's really working up the confidence and the technical ability to nail this idea where the colors are perfectly unified and balanced and create this beautiful thing called pointillism. It's such a rare work. He passed away, like I said, at the age of 31 from either pneumonia or meningitis, we're not sure which. But in spite of that, these works were highly appreciated. And, thank you. Here's an example. Here's a nice historic photo of this being exhibited in Paris back in 1936. And this was an exhibition devoted solely to the artist. And then moving forward, we know that these Grand Camp sailing scenes become important to collectors because in 2018, one sold on the market for $34 million. So he's such an important artist. I think he really captivates the imagination of so many people. He really appeals to those who are both more artistically minded, those more scientifically minded. And it's just such a great pleasure to be able to spend time up close with this nice intimate work by one of the biggest art historical names.
I'll add one thing. They asked a whole bunch of art lovers, art historians, if every museum in the world deaccessioned all their works, what would be the most valuable works? Number one, no big surprise, Mona Lisa. Number two, George Seurat's Sunday Afternoon in the park. And that's at the Art Institute of Chicago. And most people felt that that would be the second most valuable painting, work of art, in the entire world if it was ever deaccessioned. And that really says it all. And this painting had a direct say in that painting, because it wasn't until he perfected his impressionist technique doing this and the other small paintings that he did in Normandy that he perfected it, that he was able to go back and paint that wonderful masterpiece that is pleasured so many people, including Ferris Bueller, I guess.
And his friends.
Oh, great. Thank you. It's a wonderful one to end on, that's for certain. That's the last painting we're going to be looking at tonight. But now we're going to open things up to some questions. I just want to remind everyone, if you do have a question that you would like to ask, either about Impressionism, about the art market, about the gallery in general, you feel free to do so. We are here to answer anything you could possibly ask us. There's a Q&A button at the bottom of your screen, and just send it off to us and we'll try to get to it. We are going to dive right into some of these great questions that have been coming through. We've had two people who have asked this particular question. They're pointing out that the frames are spectacular on these works. How important is it that there's an original or period frame, and what kind of value does that add to an artwork?
I'll answer that. That's a great question. And there was an art critic in the 19th century that stated he had never seen a painting that wouldn't be improved by a better frame. And you know, frame is somewhat a personal taste. Would you like an original frame on a painting? The answer is of course, but that doesn't mean it's the best frame for the painting. The Impressionists often, keep in mind, these paintings hung above fancy bronze-mounted French furniture. I know that sounds crazy because now we think of them in these big white walls and open-air places, but where these were meant to were over French furniture, and often they would go into the antique market and buy 18th century frames or early 19th century frames, which were very inexpensive in those days, not anymore, and put their paintings in there or paint a painting to the scale of the frame. And so, because they liked a soft look to off the Impressionists, liked a not a very gold look, but obviously there's exceptions to every rule. And so in a perfect world, you would love an original frame, but it's not really that important if it has a great frame on it.
Thank you, Bill. All right, our next question here. Can you talk a little bit about the market for Impressionist paintings? Do you think that prices will continue to climb?
I can answer that, and you can feel free to chime in. Basically, the reason that we chose to talk about Impressionism tonight is because it's so universally beloved. It's really hard to dislike this movement. It brings so many people joy. And Essentially, the supply becomes smaller and smaller over the years. When paintings end up in museums, they most of the time will stay there. And there's no reason that these paintings shouldn't hold and grow their value. It's a market that has, we've seen continued growth over the last decades. And I mean, you can see why.
I think the best example is the Monet that you mentioned earlier that sold for 100, I think it was 110 million, the Haystacks, had sold in the 1960s, and I think it brought $800,000. So, whereas Impressionism used to be an American and French market, it's collected all over the world. It's collected in Japan, it's collected in China, it's collected all over the world, it's loved all over the world. And when you have something that's loved all over the world and it's in museums all over the world, that's usually, and they're not painting anymore, that's usually a good sign that the market will continue to increase.
Okay, thank you. All right, we also have a few questions about, on this topic. Can you speak to the major differences between French and American Impressionism and how those differences might influence the collector?
Sure. If we're talking about the contemporary collector, that is, I'm not sure which the question was referring to. I would say that, first of all, there's value differences on the market. One is a little bit more accessible from a financial perspective, so that might influence some collectors. But the other thing is, I think there's a sense of kind of pride and patriotism that comes with collecting American Impressionists for American collectors. Oftentimes, the locations that these artists worked are places that collectors spend their time, Carmel being a great example. And so, you know, I think it's sometimes a matter of sheer taste and preference because their techniques did vary a little bit, but oftentimes it's just a matter of what collectors can get their hands on, because I know many folks who would be happy with any of the names that we discussed tonight.
I would add to that, you know, sometimes, you know, the differences are, if you looked at the Hassam, that could easily have been a Monet. There's no difference in looks to it. It's just a A++ painting. But then you look at the William Merritt Chase, and that could have only been done in France. I mean, there's desert in there. It's different landscape. It feels different than a French impression. But a lot of that is not the fact that it was back to where it was painted. And you know, things evolve and artists evolve. And if an artist is painting the same thing and then all of a sudden they want to start painting something else, often they need to for financial reasons, because the collectors already have that and they want to paint something different. So and they always are going to take on the scenes of what they see. And so American work is going to look a little bit differently sometimes than the French work.
Thank you. Since we're talking about the differences between two styles, Impressionism and American Impressionism, we also have another question. For a non-artist, is there a set of parameters that would indicate a painting is from the Impressionist period versus the post-Impressionist period? And as a follow-up to that question, they also ask, were there artists who painted in both of these styles, both Impressionist and post-Impressionist?
Okay, I'll start and Rebecca can chime in. If you know, from a purely art historical format, you know, it was just the painters that exhibited in the Impressionist exhibitions that were considered the Impressionists. That's being very strict. Most people that painted during that period, unequivocally, we would consider Impressionists whether they painted in the exhibitions or not, or they painted right after the exhibitions had ended or not. And using that same strict rules, you know, anybody after that was post-impressionist. But there's this fine line. Pissarro is this great example of somebody. He was sort of the grandfather of all the artists. He was the oldest by far, and he was definitely, he painted a number of impressionists, and then he converted to post-impressionism and pointillism and the visionalism and all the other methods that the post-impressionists use. So yes, a lot of them went on, and they went on because some of them went on because they had to find something different because they needed to make money, and some of them went on because they could afford to and wanted to experiment with other things.
I guess I would just, I'll just add to that, just to answer the first half of the question, color would probably be the most telling thing when you're really looking for a clear differentiation. Whereas, of course, you know, the Monet, you're very lucky if you find a sunset that happens to be that purple, but it does happen. When you look at some of the post-impressionism, that's when post-impressionist painters, Van Gogh being a great example, that's when it starts to sort of separate from things that you might see in nature and things that you might imagine in your mind.
Thank you. All right. Our next question here, is it harder, I assume on the market, to find impressionist works than other styles?
Yes, by far. Well, and obviously, if you're talking about like old masters by Michelangelo or Leonardo da Vinci, no, it's not harder. But if you're talking about, you know, virtually everything else painted in the past couple hundred years, yes, by far.
Great. All right. Were the post-impressionists friends with each other?
Absolutely. I think they took a lot of inspiration from one another, and it's no coincidence that movements kind of happen simultaneously, and oftentimes it really is just because they're reviewing each other's work, they're critiquing it, they're exhibiting alongside each other. I've heard from artists that they find sometimes that they're being influenced by their peers subconsciously. So just by spending time looking at these styles of works, there are aspects of them and elements of them that they take on, sometimes on purpose and other times not. But yeah, it's always fun to read about the camaraderie of artists. I'm reading a book about Picasso right now, and you know, you can only imagine the kind of conversations they might be having over at their cafes in the evening all together.
Thank you. All right, you had mentioned that you had visited Monet's house in Giverny. What grabbed your attention most at his home?
So when I went to Giverny, first of all, I arrived there and there's this long line outside the house, and you have to take a train there, and luckily it was a beautiful day, and I was sitting and when you first get there, you go into his house, and my first thought was, what a disappointment. I was just, there's fake paintings on the wall. You know, they have copies of paintings on the wall and not great copies, you know, and I'm looking and I'm walking through the house, and the house itself is okay. It's, you know, relatively run down. It's, you know, it's okay. It's nothing. And my thought is, damn, I wasted 4.5 hours to come here. And then I went outside into his gardens. And I will tell you, in my family, my daughter's the garden warden, my wife's the garden one. I'm not the garden guy. I walked outside and I was just, my breath was taken away with how beautiful his gardens were. And you could see the inspiration. You could see some of his paintings, the little bridge over the pond and the flower. You could see where he painted. And it was just, I didn't want to leave there. It turned from what I was thinking was a really bad move by myself to go there to one of the best things I've ever done in my life. And I would counsel anybody to go there on a beautiful summer day if they can, because it's just, the gardens are just, they're awe-inspiring.
Thank you. All right, I personally love this next question, but it's a bit of a hypothetical, so we'll see what you guys think here. All right, he says, I'm a 16-year-old and I took an art history class last year at school. I was wondering where you think art would be today if Impressionism, whether it be French, American, or post, never happened.
That's tough, but it's a great question. Thank you.
You want me to answer?
I'm just digesting. It's a difficult question.
Okay, no more 16-year-olds asking questions.
Questions are too good.
So something has to break the mold. In the 19th century, you have the French state basically saying this is good art. They had a list of art saying, you know, this is best art, this is okay art, this is decent art, this is not acceptable art. They had a list. And somebody had to come along and break the mold. And if Impressionists had not come along, certainly the mold would have gotten broken sooner or later, but it would have been later. It would have been then. And art would look different today than it does. How would it look? That's an impossible no, but it would, it had to break the mold. There would have been no Picasso. There would have been no Rothko. There would have been, you know, none of that would have happened in the way it had happened without the Impressionists breaking the mold first.
Yeah, as an art professional, it's kind of a scary world to consider, but it's
okay. No more 16-year-olds.
It's an interesting hypothetical. All right, our next question here. Rebecca, you mentioned collectors in relation to American Impressionism. Can you talk a little bit more about the importance of collectors and the development of that style?
Sure. I mean, as with any movement or period or style, things come in and out of favor on the market to an extent. What I think is interesting about American Impressionism is you can kind of understand American history by looking at it, its collection history. And what I mean by that is it was kind of after the Civil War, there starts to be more noticeable wealth in the United States. And kind of as people look for ways to spend their money and are, you know, searching for status symbols or developing new interests, that's when American collectors kind of later in the 19th century start to take an interest in Impressionism. And as I mentioned earlier, that's kind of where American Impressionism springs out. I would argue that there's been consistent interest in these artists, but as with any period of time, you know, what the museums are exhibiting will often influence collectors. So when you see any major retrospective or group exhibition at a big museum or a traveling exhibition that showcases these artists, there tends to be renewed interest. So sometimes you can kind of trace, I'm not saying there's by any means a big fluctuation, but you can kind of trace some of the peaks and find out where there was a major showing of these artists' works.
Okay, great. You did mention museums, so I want to ask this question that's relevant. You've mentioned buying pieces from museums before, but have you ever sold to a museum?
Oh yeah, we've sold to museums many, many, many times, all over the world. I don't know if there's any museums on this watching, so I've got to be a little bit careful what I say. Forgetting COVID, because now they're impossible with COVID, you know, because obviously museums are having huge funding issues. But even pre-COVID, they were always never easy. Often, they liked something, they would want to put it on hold, they'd want to have board meeting, they'd want to, and the process could take months. We love selling to museums. We love the prestige of having our pieces in museums all over. I would say, though, probably the majority of our paintings, it's just the majority of our objects that have ended up in museums, we didn't sell to the museums, but we sold to collectors who eventually gifted them to museums. So the people got to enjoy them their whole life or a good portion of life and then gifted them. And that's, to me, like the best of all worlds. But yes, we love selling to museums, but although in the COVID world, it's darn near impossible because they're just struggling to pay their people.
Thank you. I do want to interject really quickly. I know we're coming up on 6 p.m., which is usually the time that we end this. We do have another couple more questions to get to, so we're going to go a little bit on. But if anyone needs to click off, I do want to remind you that you're going to be sent a survey after this webinar. If you could please go ahead and fill that out. It really helps us with planning for our next Bourbon with Phil. So thank you for joining us. If you are signing off now, but let's continue with a few more questions, shall we?
Sure.
All right. Next up, what is your opinion of the effect of outdoor lighting on an important painting versus indoor lighting, and which one is more adverse to the painting?
Oh, you can answer that. I can.
Either way.
Go ahead.
Well, I would advise against natural light hitting paintings just strictly for conservation purposes. It has the ability to fade or dry out the pigments. And if you visited the gallery, you've seen that we have very controlled lighting and we put a lot of energy into making sure our paintings look beautiful. And that's something that you have a little bit more ability to control with artificial lighting. And while it is nice to see these sorts of works near you know, a natural environment like they might have been painted in, because they are important historic objects that themselves very well might end up in a museum one day, I encourage you to keep them outside of natural light.
Although, having said that, it's not natural light, it's not bad for a painting. What's bad for a painting is the UV lights. So if you have a window, and virtually every modern window today has a UV filter built in, then it's okay. I still prefer artificial light because you can control it. You know, you don't have to, yes, that painting may look great at 4 o'clock, but you know, this way the painting can look good at 8 o'clock or in PM or 8 o'clock AM also. And so artificial light is to me always the best.
Great, thank you. All right. Where are the works on paper from the same artist that we discussed here today in terms of appreciation and collectability? So if instead of an oil on canvas, you have a pastel on paper, where does that fall in terms of collectability?
I can start.
Go ahead.
So generally speaking, there are always artists who are exceptions. Artists tended to be more prolific with their works on paper than they were with their canvases. So that does mean that canvases or panels are more rare and therefore more valuable. But any work especially the ones that are more highly finished, any work on paper by an artist of historical importance is likely to appreciate over time. So it's a nice entryway. So a work on paper, meaning a drawing, is probably going to be more valuable than something like an edition, a lithograph, an etching, and that's because it's still unique. There's still only one of them. They just might have made 10 in one day, or with an edition, you know, their printer might have printed 50 of that one image.
I would add, as a general rule, oils are more valuable than works on paper, but they tend to go up at the same rate. And, you know, so if you bought a work on paper for X or a oil for 5X, I think they're going to appreciate about the same. But Rebecca said, every artist was different. There are artists that were known for works on paper, and they did really great things on paper, and those could be worth as much, if not more, than an oil.
Okay, thank you. You talked a little bit about UV rays with our previous question. Here's a follow-up to that. Can you talk a little bit generally about conserving your works and how to take care of a painting?
Well, paintings are really pretty easy. I mean, if you hang them up, don't let UV rays hit them, and don't smoke, you'll be fine. And even if you do smoke, I'll share a story with you. One of the great sales of 19th century art, not impressionist, but 19th century salon art, was there was a restaurant in Baltimore, Maryland called Hausman's. And they had this extraordinary collection, and people, if you had money, you lived anywhere near Baltimore, you would have been familiar in the 40s, 50s, 60s, and 70s eating at Hausman's restaurant. It was a place to go. Beautiful art all around. It's hung salon style. So, you know, they had many paintings on the wall, and they were all over. Well, in those days, people smoked in restaurants. And they would have served, you know, they would have probably had two servings at lunch, you know, not food servings, but, you know, two sittings, I should say, at lunch of people, and maybe two or three for dinner. So on a normal day, they would have had four groups of people or five groups of people at a table, of which many of them smoked and sat there, and the paintings had this thick cover of it. Somewhere, I want to say it was around 1990, in the late 80s, the restaurant closed, and there in 1990, it was an auction at Sotheby's of all their works. And I remember going there, and it was just such a great thing because the paintings were pretty ugly in the sense that they had this thick fog on it. But because it was cigarette smoke, all they had to do was be cleaned. And they cleaned up stunningly beautiful. They actually had like a protective layer on top of it. I don't recommend that you smoke to put that protective layer on it, but as long as you bring something into a good conservator, if it's cleaned and it's cleaned correctly, most paintings we have either have been cleaned or don't need to be cleaned. And there's really no thing you have to do to it to take care of it. It really does take care of itself.
Thank you. All right, let's get back to American Impressionism. The term was often applied to art that originated in New York and the nearby towns and villages. Can you comment on the other regional centers of American Impressionism, such as Bucks County or California?
They went where the money was. I think, forget New York, you know, put aside in New York, Boston, certainly, crazy enough, New Hampshire, Hassan painted some wonderful paintings in New Hampshire. He would go there for the summer and paint. Not just Boston, but all of the New England coast. Not so much in the South. Part of that was, perhaps post-Civil War, the South was quite poor. And later on in the West, there's some wonderful California Impressionists from Frisco Cita. I mean, artists that you could look at and say were clearly influenced by the Impressionists. And part of that, there was starting to be great wealth in California and great natural beauty. And you put those two together, the artists came and painted.
Great, thank you. I love this next question. You're going to have to flip through your memory banks. Out of all the Impressionist works that have come through your collection, what was your personal favorite and why? I know it's tough.
Well, last year we had a really important Hassam that was life scale. So it also depicted his wife and one of their favorite scenes. It was a site on the coast, I'm forgetting exactly where, but that he had painted the scene without his wife, and then he did a version with her seated, and it was to scale. It was very similar in kind of nature to the one that we looked at tonight, but seeing all of his kind of impasto and talent and beautiful palette at such a large scale was so impactful to me.
I can't answer the question, not won't, but just can't. I'd have to look, and they're all my other children. I love them all, and so I'd have a hard time. I'd have a really hard time saying which was my favorite.
Perhaps it's because I'm a mother, but I love all the Mary Cassatts that come through our door. She has such great mother and child scenes. Those always personally touch my heart a little bit. But yeah, like you said, Bill, each one's always better than the last that you bring home to us. So great. Okay. So our next question here, please define the difference between a study and an artist-proof painting. I think this is going back to the question about the prints and works on paper.
Sure. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, the concept of an artist-proof is typically specific to the idea of a print. So a study could be for any final form of work of art, even including sculpture. So an artist proof would have typically been one that the artist ran before printing a final edition, whereas a study could be a drawing or even a painterly sketch of anything that they were preparing to ultimately realize in a more finished fashion.
You'll see studies much more non-impressionist art than impressionist art. The reason why is non-impressionist, it would draw it out on a piece of paper first and, get everything right. Impressionist, it was much more winging it and without drawing underneath it. Probably the greatest example of the drawing ones is like Norman Rockwell, who everybody's familiar with. You'll see these rough sketches where he sort of sketches it, some of it out, and the people will be one third drawn, and then he'll do a finished sketch and then a painting. But his painting is almost always different than his finished sketch. The hand was here in the finished sketch, but it may be here. Everything's just a little bit different. He may have added something, as he got it. So all of them are valuable, all of them are desirable. Obviously a finished work is always more valuable than a study.
Okay, thank you. We have one more question tonight that we're going to end on. When is the next Bourbon with Bill and what is the topic? Don't worry, you guys are off the hook. I will answer that question. it's going to be in about a month's time. We've been doing these throughout the pandemic, as you know, every 4 weeks or so. So the next one will be in October, just before the Halloween holiday. As for the topic, we don't know yet, and that's where we need your help. So after this webinar, you're going to receive a survey, just asking for your impressions. And then as a follow-up, if you'd like to give some ideas for the next topic, whatever you'd like to hear about, we are certainly open to your suggestions. We want to make sure that these webinars remain relevant and remain interesting to you. So anything that you would like to hear from us, we are more than happy to entertain those ideas. So please send them along. With that, I will say thank you, Rebecca and Bill, so much for joining us tonight. I think I speak for everyone when I say that it was a very enlightening topic. It was great to have you both here to hear both of your opinions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Amanda.
Thank you.
Great. And thank you everyone who attended tonight. We hope to see you at the next Bourbon with Bill in about 4 weeks' time. Take care now. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.